when an incumbent behind race to become Maryland's 33rd comptroller. Prior to his election, he served for 20 years as a delegate of Montgomery County. Over the last 8 years serving as comptroller, Peter Franchot has been an independent voice and a fiscal watchdog for the taxpayers of Maryland. As a member of the powerful Board of Public Works and Vice Chair of the State Retirement and Pension System of Maryland, Comptroller Franchot has worked tirelessly to keep Maryland competitive in a knowledge-based economy, create a climate of economic equality and opportunity, and protect taxpayer money. Comptroller Peter Franchot has worked closely with business leaders throughout the state on issues that affect Maryland's economy and fiscal strength. Since becoming the state's Chief Financial Fiscal Officer, Peter Franchot has worked to level the playing field for Maryland taxpayers, cracking down on cigarette smugglers and illegal alcohol and motor fuel sales. He has closed tax loopholes and launched the first in the nation program to ensure that federal contractors are paying their fair share of state taxes and ensure statewide compliance with Maryland's minority business enterprise participation goals. And finally, under his leadership, the Comptroller's Office has received national acclaim as the most efficient effective controllers works in the country. It's my great pleasure to introduce Maryland Comptroller Peter Franchot.
Jerry, why don't you stay here, follow? Maybe you could come up, because I understood today that this was the 871st meeting. And you're celebrating your 90th anniversary, so I decided to, on behalf of the great state of Maryland, well, let me just say, first of all, I'm going to present to Paula and to Jerry each one of my much coveted comptroller medals.
Ooh!
No, they still have to pay their taxes. But I see Ken Reichert sitting back there, who works with Senator Cardin. And I gave one of these to the Teacher of the Year last year. Went back to my seat. It's a big gala with 1,000 people. It's a wonderful celebration of teachers. And I happen to be sitting next to Senator Paul Sarbanes, former Senator Paul Sarbanes, talking about an icon in Maryland politics. And he leaned over to me and he said, "God, those medallions are kind of cool. Do you have another one?" So I knew that they were, well, I give them to Marylanders to make a difference. Paul and Jerry. This is presented on behalf of the great state of Maryland to the Montgomery County Civic Federation in recognition of your 90th anniversary and celebration of your dedication to preserve and improve the quality of life for all current and future residents of Montgomery County. God bless each and every one of you. With my appreciation for your commitment to provide a strong voice for citizens in our political process, best wishes for many more years of success and advocacy presented this 9th day of November 2015. Yes, yeah. And I'd like to salute Delegate Craig Zucker and Delegate and Mich County Council Member, former Delegate Tom Hucker. Tom took my seat in the legislature when I was lucky enough to get elected comptroller. Craig works for me when he's not in the legislature. When he's in the legislature, he's like a rocket taking off. He's done more in 5 years than I did in 20 years. And, well, put it this, not sure about the accomplishments, but I pretty much guarantee he's got a heck of a lot higher ranking positions than I have had. So, if you need any money for any good cause here in Montgomery County, go see Craig Zucker. He's sitting right on a ton of it down there in Annapolis. Craig, thank you for producing the proclamation and helping me get here tonight. And I was listening to Ricardo, what a wonderful program that is that he's got. And I was just remembering my daughter when she was a young girl, and I would drive her to the dance down whatever it was, somewhere down in Washington usually, and she would make me stop several blocks away. Yeah, it's just way too embarrassing to be seen with you, especially with those short gym shorts you have on. So could you please just drop me off here? The idea of me getting out on the dance floor with her in the father-son competition, well, wasn't going to happen in my household, that's for sure. I would have done it. Anyway, now she's 34, newly married, has a fabulous job, makes more money in a month than I make in years up in New York, and is, like so many of our kids, just having a wonderful experience based on her background in Montgomery. Like she called me last week, she said, "I'm going to be a grandpa." Well, she's mellowed a lot. She's actually. But I'm delighted to be here. Maryland has the most powerful Board of Public Works, the only one in the country. For some reason, it actually dates back to the financial scandals of the early 1900s when Maryland officially went bankrupt. Based on actions of the legislature, and so they set up the Board of Public Works to supervise the finances of the state. And they had the wisdom and the constitutional amendment that established the Board of Public Works to put me on it as one of three votes: the governor, the treasurer who's elected by the legislature, and the comptroller. Why is that significant? I'm independently elected by you. I've been elected three times. I got more than a million votes the last two elections. Thank you very much. But that gives me the ability to, when I vote on the Board of Public Works, to be objective. I don't have to toe the line of the governor or the legislature. I'm independent. And that's a huge help to citizens because it guarantees an extra set of eyes, and depending on who is in the comptroller seat, that's a very important opportunity to not be the normal rubber stamp. Most states have boards like the Board of Public Works, but they're appointed people by the governor. So the governor generally controls it. The Board of Estimates in Baltimore City, wonderful group of people, but you know, there are five people on the Board of Estimates, and three of them are appointed by the mayor. So, right, there's not a lot of uncertainty about which way a certain issue is going to go when it comes before the board. Board of Public Works in Maryland voted on 18,000 contracts totaling $85 billion of state spending. And maybe 1% of them I've objected to, but I famously got into some heated discussions with our former governor, Mark O'Malley. And that's okay. That's the point of checks and balances. And on the Board of Public Works, if you don't have two votes, the contract dies. No due process, no if, ands, or buts, or geesh, gosh. Can't you, don't you understand this is a very, very important exercise? No, if you don't have two votes, contract goes down. So it's a fabulous arena and a great tool for citizens because there are lots of instances where the state acts inappropriately, and the last court of resort is the Board of Public Works. Right now we have a big project up in Baltimore County, which is a county ruled by fear. My party controls City Hall there in Towson. It's a county that's run by machine politicians that are just absolutely my way or the highway. As far as the citizens, forget it. You can't even stand up and object. Do that up in Baltimore County, pretty soon you find yourself in a very awkward position. It's outrageous. Anyway, they had a big project up there that the machine really wants, and they forgot that it involved a former school that they were taking with a big chunk of public park land giving to private development. They forgot that since it was a school, state property, it had to get a vote, according to the covenants, a vote of approval from the Board of Public Works. So they had everything lined up. Citizens were told to go jump in a lake. The developer had the plans. The county exec and everybody else had the thing all lined up. Sheesh, Governor Hogan and I said, no, you can't do that. Right at the 11th hour. What about our rights? Feel free to call the Supreme Court if you want. The Board of Public Works has total authority and power. And you know who we suck up for up there? All the citizen groups. Dundalk United. Go up there and ask them about whether they think citizens have power or not. They do have power. So anyway, you guys have power too. If you get something that's hot before the Board of Public Works, come and see me. We try to do the right thing. And you guys try to do the right thing. And you're not so conflicted as we are in politics with all this toxicity about the other parties. I have my party come to me and say, you've got to do this because you're a Democrat. Making the Democrats look bad. Making the Democrats look bad. I'm sticking up for the citizens. So that three-person board, if you apply, provides a level of transparency and accountability in so many things, but the procurement process particularly. And I can pretty much guarantee you that it's the best darn sunlight, it's the best doggone disinfectant of corruption and collusion that you can imagine. Because it's a setting like this with several hundred people where they have to stand up. If I ask a question about a contract, somebody has to stand up and answer it in public. You know how hard that is. I'm not talking about a legal memo or something. Here's your Mr. Comptroller, the answers to your concerns, and let me cover it up with all this bureaucratic shellac. No, you have to stand up. It's like being in high school and having to deliver an oral report rather than handing in a paper. It's brutal if you're not on the right side. So it's, they say sunlight is a good disinfectant. I say the Board of Public Works is a good disinfectant. So I'm also a member of the Capital Debt Affordability Committee, which makes a recommendation each year to the Governor and the General Assembly on how much money the state can borrow to fund capital projects like building schools, hospitals, and rec centers. I'm chair of the Board of Revenue Estimates, which meets quarterly and determines the money that we expect to get in our tax collection procedures. That's the number that the legislature has to use as far as the budget. I have a window into the entire state's economy. Vice chair, because of being comptroller of the Board of Trustees of the State Retirement System, a $44 billion figure portfolio for our rank and file teachers and our state employees. I follow in the footsteps of my legendary predecessors. The obviously, Louis Goldstein handed out millions of gold coins. Everybody, his were plastic. stuff. Louis was a little tight with a dollar. And then another Maryland legend, William Donald Schaefer. And I regularly salute him with William Donald Schaefer Helping People Awards that I give to not-for-profits all around the state who, whatever you thought of Governor Schaefer, I mean, the man was someone who would always help the little guy. And that was was struggling at the end of his political career, but I salute him as a giant in Maryland politics. And so I help a lot of people. Let me discuss a couple of initiatives that I have. A common sense proposal on school scheduling. I think that we need to give Maryland families a break and start bringing the kids back for K through 12 public school no earlier than the day after Labor Day. I think that gives a break to students who frankly learn more during their summer vacations than they do in school. I mean, this is, school has gotten, we've developed an obsession with these tests, and almost a fetish with testing that is just beyond belief. And we're not even testing the kids on anything that is important to them. I mean, I took algebra, I took geometry, I took trigonometry. They're all completely useless to me. I suppose I could memorize everything and go back and do it.
Easy work for NASA.
Yeah, luckily I did not work for NASA. But gotten off track, and we have so many brilliant teachers in the state. I've visited more schools than any politician in the history of the state. I went to visit this morning. I was at Magruder High School with 100 kids who are involved in financial literacy. And so the teachers are fabulous, but they're not allowed to teach anymore. They have to test and be held accountable based on the tests. The tests are changing, and the tests, many of the parents and teachers can't answer the questions themselves. And so we've gotten ourselves all tied up into knots, and we have smothered the genius of the public school education system. And somehow we're going to have to break out of that. So one thing that I have is I'd like to have a moratorium on testing for 12 months. Let's see if the sky falls. People said, oh, the federal government's going to sue us with whole funding. Hogwash. They wouldn't do that in many years. In fact, President Obama just put out a big critique of over-testing. He's the one who created a lot of it, so I suppose it's appropriate that he try to rein it in. But there's no way the feds are going to cut back on funding. If seniors need it for college stuff, I can see that. I'm not opposed to those standardized tests. But every other standardized test, I would put on the shelf for a year and see whether we're all still standing. See how the teachers, when they're liberated from those constraints, can do what they're good at. So anyway, I don't know how I got onto that, but I'll leave the moratorium on testing aside and go back to school after Labor Day, which I think is a fabulous common sense idea. It's supported by everybody in the state of Maryland except for the teachers union and the superintendents. Other than those 40 people, perhaps, who are the leaders of those groups, everybody else supports them, including Governor O'Malley and Governor Hogan. And so hopefully we will see that come through. It's my role in that is as the state's chief fiscal officer. There are enormous economic benefits that this proposal will have without costing you, the taxpayers, a bent dime. We start school after Labor Day, you automatically add 10 to 14 days onto the tourism end of summer season. And that's not just Ocean City and Deep Creek Lake, it's also every other community, Baltimore, for example, with the Orioles. Think about families taking their kids to, the Orioles get going and actually start getting the playoffs. But the end of August, you know, you can take your kid to a night game at Camden Yards. You can't do that when we go back to school. It's too late. So it adds millions of dollars of direct impact to the state economy coming back after Labor Day, millions of dollars in direct wages, millions in added state and local revenue to improve our schools, keep our streets safe, clean up the bay, fix our roads and bridges. So that's a common sense idea that I think I will succeed on. I'm not exactly sure how, because the legislature's told me to go jump in the lake. They don't like it because the teachers don't like it and the superintendents don't like it. So I'm not quite sure how I'm going to come out of that, but I would urge everybody to stay tuned. Because miracles happen. Think of me if you read about it. In fact, it is happening. I've been working on improving financial literacy, as I mentioned. I think we should have a graduation requirement that kids have to demonstrate that they know what a budget is, what debt is, what compound interest is. That's the only math I would really require. Because with that, they can arm themselves to protect themselves against predatory practices. Also learn the basics of how to accumulate wealth. And I tell kids it's the most important civil right that we have in this country. What is that? It's the right to financial literacy. And it's the one thing you need in order to develop personal happiness and have a dignified, independent life. And that is some idea of how to handle money. Doesn't mean you have to make $1 million. Means you have to have an understanding of how our system works and how to protect yourself and how to accumulate enough money that you don't have to live with your parents or
getting into constant arguments with your spouse. I mean, think of it, think of your own personal lives. How much friction there is around money. Most of it's because we never taught our kids, and to the extent we don't teach them, I think we do a disservice. I'm delighted to see Montgomery County following the leadership of Prince George's County in forming a finance academy. And Capital One has agreed with the school system to put all our eighth graders in Maryland in Montgomery County through a 14-lesson program in the school taught by their teacher about financial literacy. And then they're going to go to a finance academy where they're given an income and a real life experience in how to negotiate a car loan, have a mortgage, pay utility bills, figure out how much to spend on groceries. And you know, you buy the big shiny red Dodge Ram truck and you're not going to have any money left over to buy a driveway to park the family. Kids love this, or gas, or groceries, or things like that. So financial literacy is a passion of mine. I call it the silver light, to distinguish it from the other silver lights, but I think it is way up in front of the number one initiative that can guarantee that we give our kids the potential to be happy. You know, there's no guarantee that they will be happy, but the opportunity to be. Okay, then the other last issue I want to comment on is my initiative that I announced recently, where I will ask that the legislature consider legislation as offered from my agency and Montgomery County's alcohol monopoly. It's been making headlines throughout the state and in the county. Because everybody knows the antiquated, inefficient system that we have here in Montgomery County is unacceptable. And government's great at doing a lot of things. I have wonderful friendships with Hans Beamer and all the members of the county council. But tremendous things they do beautifully well, but selling alcohol is not something they do well. And so we're going to modernize and bring it into the 21st century alcohol distribution in Montgomery County. You got a question?
Sorry, I wasn't hearing
you.
What did you say? Alcohol?
Yeah. Right now, if you could believe it, Montgomery County is the only county, I believe, in the country where every beer, bottle of wine, glass of wine you buy at a hotel or tavern or restaurant or any beer or wine you buy in a retail store or any one of the 25 county stores that where you can only purchase liquor, spirits. All of that alcohol goes through a warehouse controlled by the county. And it's something that dates back to Prohibition when people were really concerned about the health impact and the criminality of alcohol and during the Prohibition period, and so they passed this very tightly controlled system, and it has somehow survived for 70 years, and it now we need to liberate the county from this really antiquated idea. I pay 42% more for vodka if I buy it in Montgomery County than if I cross the district line right near my house and buy it in Morris Mill. Guess where I shop? Don't tell anybody, but you know, how about Calvary Women over there in Connecticut? I mean, it's a cottage industry, the liquor stores on the D.C. side of the border, because it's so messed up on the county side with this public monopoly. So I view it as a consumer tax. Obviously, there are whole differences as far as customer service and customer choice between the private sector and the public sector. And it's not, I'm not critical of the public sector. I'm just saying that it's not, this is not something that we're good at. And that's why all of the rest of the state, we don't have that. We have one county out on the Eastern Shore, Ocean City, that had a system somewhat like
Montgomery's, and several years ago, we passed legislation that said, look, we're not going to tell you, Worcester County, to stop your public monopoly. We're simply going to let the private sector in. They're going to be able to provide alcohol directly to your hotels and restaurants and taverns and your retail stores. And the first year, about 50% of the business moved from the county to the private side. Now it's about 85% second year. And third year, they're going to phase out the public side. Why? I mean, people vote with their feet. And so, as Maryland's chief tax collector and regulator, I am the chief alcohol regulator for the state liquor laws, I can say without hesitation that this would be a huge boom for the economy in Montgomery County. Yes, there is about $30 million in revenue that is given to the county from this operation, but that is not a particularly large money when you look at the $5 billion county budget and realize that every other county in the state of Maryland has somehow managed to fund its critical services without having a liquor monopoly. So the argument that we need to keep a bad system going, even though we know it's inefficient and our citizens don't like it at all, the idea that we have to keep it going because we get some money from it is really something that I would love to get your support in correcting, because it's a ludicrous argument for a really bad program to say we got to keep it because we get money from it. The other argument is that these, I'll get to you in just one second, is that there are union employees in Worcester County in these liquor stores. I am a very strong pro-union, pro-labor Democrat. But guess what? The Teamsters in the private sector will represent these workers. So UFCW won't. But I'm supposed to defend a really bad idea that hurts our consumers and our business in Montgomery County because I want one union rather than another union to represent the workers of them. It's not the way the system works. So I think it's going to happen, but once again, everybody tells me I'm crazy that there's no chance this will get through. But maybe if the Civic Association picked it up, gave me a little firepower here and help out, I would be delighted, because the bill is going in. It's going to be considered as a statewide bill, not a local bill. And put it this way, those folks that want to protect the current system are going to have to stand up in public and answer to the 75% of our citizens that desperately want this thing to be opened up to competition. Yes?
First, do you have a bill number for the statewide bill?
Yeah, I haven't, no, we haven't. I just announced that I'm asking the legislative leaders to put it in. We're drafting it right now, but it will be very similar in concept to the Worcester County bill, which has worked so well, where we simply say, okay, as of July 1st, 2016, the private sector is allowed to participate in a similar way to the public side, and let the best provider prevail.
Of the several Montgomery.
Well, I'll let you know what the bill is.
Okay, that would be very helpful. Of the local bills that are being put in, and I gather there are several, which would you consider the best for the consumers?
Yeah, none of them. There are two bills that I understand. One is a piecemeal reform that Hans Riemer, who's a terrific guy, and left to himself, I think he could get rid of the whole system and let the private side in, but he's, you know, everybody's kind of walking around in eggshells. So they've come up with a piecemeal reform, which the council has voted on, and I would strongly suggest that is really an unfortunate product that they have put up there, because it basically allows specialty wine and beer to be ordered and delivered from the private side to get around the problem that the restaurants and hotels have with the county system, which is, A, you can't get through to them. B, when you go up, they're on the phone talking to their girlfriends at the time. Thirdly, they know nothing about the liquor business. Fourthly, they have an unbelievably complicated system of ordering beer. You can only do it wine once a week. And then the stuff that they deliver the following week, half of the stuff you ordered isn't there. And if it's a specialty wine or beer, you have to wait 2-3 weeks for anything to arrive. So, it, and once again, pay through the nose for it. So, that piecemeal reform that's been passed through the council, I think, is somewhat fig leaf, and it's been coupled with a massive expansion of the county-owned facilities. And if you guys could please, on behalf of the taxpayers, put your hand up and say, well, we might understand that you want to preserve the current system because of the workers and your concern about the revenue, but do you really have to build 5 new giant county liquor stores, 2 of them being superstores? I mean, how, what an absurd waste of your money that is. And I haven't seen, all I've heard is that that is somewhere in Ike's budget. And if you guys could take a look at it and get rid of it, it is a real snake just sitting there. And apparently it's coupled with this reform effort. So that's yet another reason I think the reform effort is wrong. And there's a second bill that establishes a referendum, an advisory referendum in the election in 2016. That is just a delay. That's something that I guess the legislators who don't want to be in favor of the monopoly, but don't want to get rid of the monopoly, I guess they can sign on to that as something that's a face-saving message. I think it's, you know, why don't we start the referendum on July 1st of 2016 when people get a choice? They can vote with their feet in the back and yes, then in the red shirt and then up here.
Just quickly, the taxpayers will already bring with the
yeah.
tax. We've testified this. Support it 100%
getting
out that money that Ike wants to throw at the current monopoly. I have a segue question though.
Will you include me in that loop? Because I can't find the damn thing. And I'm looking for how much money it is. I assume it's a lot, so let me know.
I'll be happy. Well, speaking of finding money, the county's in a dilemma right now with income taxes.
Yes.
We're on pins and needles awaiting a projection this month for income tax revenues to come to the county. Can you give us any kind of insight on where we're going?
Yeah, no, the income revenues around the state rose about 5% last year because of the direct gain and capital gains, which is a very volatile part of the income tax. Montgomery got particularly hit by the Wynn case, which I was the person who was pursuing, but I lost in the Supreme Court. They won, and that has a big negative impact. Revenues because we've got 50,000 amended returns that are coming in and we're going to be paying a ton of money out. Most of it is going to be deducted since it's not a state obligation, it's a county obligation. Most of it will be deducted from Montgomery County because that's where most of the wind fires live. So I would say that there's some real pressure on the county budget. I think it's $40 million this year, more over the next few years. But you know, as I said, Montgomery County is the envy of the state because it has so much wealth, so many resources. All the other counties seem to get along with a little bit of fiscal discipline, and Montgomery could benefit, frankly, from some scrubbing. You know, I'm a huge, there's nobody who's more in favor of education than I am, but boy, we could do, think about it. I mean, we're paying almost $500 a square foot to build schools in Montgomery County. They just completed one that looks like the National Museum of Art is so beautiful in Alexandria for $250. I asked folks, well, why are we building them so expensively? And they said, you don't understand. We have to build them to last for 100 years. What happens if the kids bang their heads against the walls in the hallway? Quote from the head of construction. He said, what happens when the kids bang their heads? We have to build the walls where they're strong. I said, what about the kids? You know, what do we do for them? I mean, it's become ludicrous, is what I'm saying. Uh-huh. And there are enormous ways to do better with less. Yes?
Yes, I have a question on a totally different subject, on the state retirement fund.
Yes.
California, which is the mother of all state retirement funds, has divested itself of all fossil fuels.
Right.
Is it
No, we're not going to do that. It's just, our fund is $44 billion. It's a lot of money. But it's significantly underfunded because the legislature, God bless it, always seems to take something from the contribution each year because they want to spend it on, I did it when I was in the legislature, they want to spend it on their projects. So each of those years when we lost $100 million over the last 10 years, it's all cumulative. We all have to pay. We get a reduced rate of return on our investments because we have less money. And it's all adding up. And as a result, we can't really afford that kind of a leap, much as I would perhaps support it philosophically. We need to, other than we divested from Iran contributions a couple of years ago, all of that was percolating, but I don't think we can right now realistically back out like California has. California's got some significant problems associated with their big teachers fund because they just backed out of hedge funds also. And they're going to be back into hedge funds pretty quickly because their returns are going way down. They're much bigger than we are. But we're at least solid. I can promise you that. We are going to have the money to pay for our retirees come hell or high water, but we're going to have to control ourselves about creative things that we do. We just have to get the job done. Yes.
Just to follow up on your question on the liquor bill, just to answer one question.
On the which bill?
On your county.
Liquor bill, yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, the one thing I don't understand is why liquor can't be sold at Costco or at D.C. or Virginia, and it's viewed well that for a small business, but there are small liquor stores all over D.C. You can buy liquor at the Costco or whatever.
Yeah.
And why can't you do that?
Trust me, when I ran for comptroller, I was in the liquor business, I was like always sticking up to the consumer. And I said the three-tier system that we had, which is also a hangover from prohibition, I thought was an anti-Diluvian, anti-consumer primitive thing. So they thought I was the antichrist when I got elected. And the alcohol industry is extremely powerful. I have signed kind of a truce with the alcohol industry, and they've been tremendously helpful to me in voluntarily banning caffeinated alcohol, for example, powdered alcohol, this new product that's now being sold around the country. It's like Kool-Aid, little packets of powdered alcohol that you can pour. I thought it was just insane, but to my delight, the alcohol industry in Maryland said, okay, we're going to ban that. And they have the control to make that stick. It's not like some kind of piece of legislation. When they say no powdered alcohol, no powdered alcohol. Now the problem, the flip side of that is they're very, very powerful. And it's the retailers, and the wholesalers, and the distributors, and they don't want to open up the alcohol business to grocery store sales and Costco sale of alcohol. Squash right now efforts on that. So that's why we have a system that is, it's a private sector system, but it's also one that's a little bit like a guild where they keep grocery stores and Costco, et cetera, from participating like they do in D.C. That's the answer. Yes, how are you doing?
Good, how are you doing? I want to ask you about artificial turf fields that cost three times as much as natural turf fields and soccer flex has a bunch of natural turf fields that seem to be able to work just fine. Do you see that as a problem, particularly since Montgomery County is about to convert all of their football fields to artificial turf fields?
Yeah, I'm not, I'm a little bit of an agnostic on that. I understand how expensive these are, but Prince George's has used them. And I was up in Baltimore City a couple of days ago, and they have a new artificial turf field right near the Pimlico area, which is a very tough neighborhood. So on the issue of durability and ability to protect the field, I would obviously prefer the turf fields. I think they're natural and they're more beautiful and they're better to play on. Probably less, fewer injuries. But we in Montgomery County find it's very difficult to protect fields that, unlike the soccer plex where they have, you know, folks that are making sure that you have a permit or whatever and that you are properly using the field. In Montgomery County, we have a much more open process and fields can quickly get destroyed, and they do. So I could go either way on the turf fields. I know they're expensive though. Back here and then over here and then back over here.
First of all, just a statement. Tomorrow, the Montgomery County Board of Education will be approving $2.5 million in no-bid contracts. This is, we need legislation to stop this, to make them put out more things for bids. A lot of these products and items are through the construction capital budget, and we're just bleeding money out of there. The second thing is, there's been
Can I just comment on that?
Sure.
A lot of that at the Board of Public Works, and I believe every no-bid contract, I'm not talking about a sole source contract. Sole source is when you have a software that you purchase from some company, and they're the only company that legally can maintain that software. That's a sole source bid. Single bid contracts are competitively bid, but there's just one bid. And generally, it's the incumbent vendor who generally has written the RFP in a collusive exercise with the state agency. And we see a lot of those at the state level. And I have always put my hand up and objected. And I think the single bid contracts should automatically be considered as collusive. And they shouldn't be approved. We should send them back and say, thank you very much. The trick at the Board of Public Works is they bring them up 2 weeks before they're going to expire. And they say, you can't let the kids. Oh, my God. You know.
Right.
Hey, be careful, because Hogan and Rutherford are fully capable of.
Well, the things tomorrow are like cars and trucks. I'm pretty sure you can buy them other places.
Yeah, I think your instinct is absolutely correct.
Yeah. And the second thing is there's a lot of talk about fees since Governor Hogan came, and there are fees that are being charged in Montgomery County Public Schools that have been in place for years. Our children are charged to attend public school classes. That is a violation of the Maryland Constitution. The fees are illegal. They continue to be collected, and they go into a slush fund for the principal. If you dispute your fee, it goes away. So what that is called taxing the ignorant. Those that know the law don't pay the fees, those that don't pay the fees. To date, no one in this county, no Board of Ed member, no county council member will speak out against these fees, and so they continue. It's a form of extortion. Any hope of getting anyone in Annapolis, in your office, the governor's office, to speak out about what has been going on in this county? Some of the worst fees are at our technical school, where these kids are going in for vocational technical classes. They're paying $200, $300 to take a class each semester.
Do they charge kids to play athletics?
Do they charge? Well, athletics is after school. So that is a legal fee that you can charge. These are fees to attend the classes where you get a grade. So yes, there are fees after school, and those are legal in Maryland.
I'll take a look at it. It's not at the top of my priority list, but it might be. I hadn't really thought of it. Greg, maybe you can help me understand that. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
This
Hi,
is the
I'm going to talk about a different issue.
Contract stuff.
The purple line.
Uh-huh.
And the whole, I have
Thanks.
Three
thank
questions
you.
About that. One is, I'm wondering if you're going to ask about the ridership numbers that have been calculated over the years, and it's hard to understand what's gone into it and have a look at it in terms of transparency. The second question is about this public-private partnership, and I'm trying to understand what the public benefit is, because it seems to me that it's borrowing money at a higher cost. We still have to pay it back, and it would appear that part of what it's doing is just helping take it off out of the bonding authority, and we have, one could expand the bonding authority if one wanted. And the third part is, why wouldn't, as a cost-saving measure and as helping the neighborhoods, why not consider bus rapid transit with dedicated right-of-ways and curb guidelines?
No, fair questions. Anything that this is going to come before the board, multiple opportunities, because all these contracts have to be approved. If you want more transparency, feel free to, I'll give you my email address or credit card, use card. We're happy to, within reason, make any questions that in public that you would like to have answers for and get them directly for you. This is a big project. I have to support it, but I'm more than happy to be your voice to the extent you have some questions that you want answered. And the jury's out a little bit because we don't really know what the situation is with the decrease in the state share and the uncertainty as to what the private sector actually is going to be bidding. We'll open up the bids and take a look.
Mr. Franchot, actually, isn't the decrease in the state share of direct contribution to the capital, isn't that just moving over to the concessionaire, and they will be borrowing that amount of $500 million or whatever Governor Hogan reduced it by? They'll just be borrowing, like Debbie said, they'll just be borrowing it for us to pay back at a higher interest rate. And also, the other question is the state of Maryland going to back the TIFIA bond that the concessionaire will use to borrow the $600 or $1 billion needed for capital costs?
I don't frankly know the answer to all that, but I can pretty much guarantee that any kind of oversight that you wish, even though you may disagree with me on the project, I'm happy to. That's part of the reason I think the Board of Public Works is so important. And any of you can come down and testify. It's not like the legislature where you have to jump through hoops and stuff. This is the old West. Come on down. shootouts at the old Cape Corral. So come on down and feel free to stand up and express yourself, because it's there are no rules.
So that's any time you hear anything about the performance?
No, the agenda will have the contracts sometime. I think they extended it a little bit, but once these contracts begin to take form, then we're going to put it on the board's agenda. So you can get that through the Maryland government. You can get the agenda sent to you. Just make sure nothing concerned passes by without you at least considering coming down to the department. Here and then over here. Yes, sir.
And in fact, you just vote, or you have a team of people that addresses each one of these issues, such as ridership. Or do you have?
I have a team of people that advise me on the Board of Public Works. They're very expert at asking questions. They meet with the agencies. The agencies are bringing the contracts up, saying, "We have now culminated all the negotiations. We need you guys to sign off." Which is what the board's responsibility is. The beauty of the board is that there are absolutely no criteria that are articulated in the Constitution that restrain us in any way. If I bump my knee getting into the car that morning and decided for that reason to vote against the purple line, that's it, if it's a second vote. So there's a certain beauty to the board, because it's really an opportunity for reconsideration of entire projects. I don't mean to suggest that will happen, but I'm saying that it's there. And
how big a group
With the board, when you come before the board, all the agencies are there, so they provide their own people to stand up and defend.
But of your people that are doing the investigation for the different agencies, how big is that group?
Oh, I have...
3,000.
Oh, no, I have like three people. This, I guarantee, had the Maryland Health Exchange contracts not been sidetracked away from the Board of Public Works, then the legislature gave them the discretion to go and do their own procurement process. And I met with all of these, Dr. Sharfstein, the head of the Health Exchange, I said, Josh, you're gonna just mess it up, you're gonna kill your reputation. Well, they went ahead and said, no, we're not bringing it before the board, and the taxpayers lost about $220 million. Might as well have taken it outside here on Executive Street and just lit it up in a big bonfire. And a lot of that was state money. But the rest of it was federal money, and you know, Peter, that's not real money. I mean, you don't understand the fact that 24 hours after opening up a $200 million health exchange, exactly four people in 24 hours out of however many million they thought were eligible had been able to sign up. And apparently what happened at that point was that the governor and the woman who was heading this stuff, she's still heading it up, I can't believe it. They actually physically called the four people because they doubted that they were real people. And I mean, it turned into just a debacle. And it was because, you know, you have special advantages from seeing all of these contracts. You get a feel for what needs to be examined. And that's what my staff, which is very expert, provides. It's an extra layer of oversight. And I state categorically that those contracts were brought for approval before the Board of Public Works, we would not have had what has got to be one of the most stinging failures. We're not allowed to talk about it because it's so embarrassing. It's embarrassing. Yes? Welcome. I'm sorry, if I'm going on too long, let me know.
No.
Kick me out of here.
No.
My question really is, from your perspective on the Board of Public Works, where you oversee and analyze and question the expenditure of money, we in Montgomery County don't quite have the equivalent of, what your view is on oversight of our public schools, which use close to 50% of taxpayer funds, and yet we don't have the opportunity to question them in depth with the expectation of the factual answer. So I'm wondering if you believe that maybe an inspector general might be able to
set up a Board of Public Works right here. I mean, you have, the county's got a $5 billion annual budget, bigger than most states, 16 states, demand that there be a Board of Public Works, and the key there is that they're not appointed. No IG is under someone's thumb. You have three independently elected. Model it after the Board of Public Works. It's right there in the Constitution. It's very simple and straightforward. The key is county executive, elected taxpayer watchdog, and then someone elected by the council. You may not like that, but at least you have some hope of a political deal going through there. And that, if it follows the Board of Public Works procedures, could be a big improvement.
But we don't have any authority over state function, which is education.
Oh, well, you do it through the budget. You've got, $2 billion. What is the county appropriate for education?
They won't tell us what's in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I'm speaking as a huge advocate of education, and I'm telling you right now that it is just unbelievable that the amount of money that we show at education in response to every question that comes up is, oh, send more money. How about send some better education? I mean, with the money you already have. And so I'm not suggesting you do anything other than push that, because there should be a, now that I think of it, a Board of Public Works overlooking the council and the, made up of the council, the executive, and someone that you guys elect, the people. How about a people, a people's advocate? Yes, like you, could be you.
Could be me. So I'm not as well versed in the law. I'm not a member, so I feel a little out of my element. But I'm here because I'm here with some residents from Toby Town. Toby Town is a low income black community,
right,
in Potomac, Maryland, which is multi-million dollar home, and they're tucked away behind a grove. And they lack.
How do I get there? River Road?
Mm-hmm. River Road.
Yeah, I know right where that is.
Now,
yeah.
Pennyfield Lock is where you turn. It's right near Eshworthy.
And what's your connection to them? Hmm? What is your connection?
Well, I used to live in Potomac Chase Estates, and I had a friend, India, in Toby Town. So I used to go there, and I went to school with some people from Toby Town.
Excellent. What can I do to help you?
And I'm here because I recently wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post, mm-hmm, about how I am really upset by the recent budget cuts, which included a bus to Toby Town. And I've been working with the community now since 2012, and the bus was scheduled to start on October 1, and the county basically had came up with solutions in the past that weren't really effective.
That's a county bus or a state bus?
I'm sorry?
Is it a county bus or a state?
It's county by
Right. Okay. Well, I'm happy to take a look at it.
Yeah.
Ask. It doesn't hurt to ask. And maybe I'll ask Delegate Zucker to look at that. It's something that he could, because of his position on the Appropriations Committee.
Who?
Right, sitting right behind you. Yeah, he's. He looks very young and handsome, but he's incredibly powerful in Annapolis on the budget. So why don't we share with him your information, and we'll get back to you. No guarantees. Yes, sir.
Have either you or somebody else, going back to your liquor thing, done an economic analysis of what the tax consequences, the benefits that would be obtained because of the change to a private rather than a public system, because of all of these years? I remember if you did shop at if you left the store and you went across the and you went right out the store and you drove into Maryland, you'd get stopped. And the same thing was true with many of the liquor stores downtown. They look for Maryland cars and wait till they cross into Maryland and stop them.
Yeah, well, we don't do that anymore because I'm the chief enforcement officer.
Okay.
But I don't want anybody stopping it.
But has there been any economic analysis? Because this to me is the way to get support.
Yeah.
Where you could show we're going to get the revenues, and I the tax revenues that everybody's going to, you know, get the same is going to increase substantially because of just greater sales.
Yeah.
Than anything else.
Yeah, the problem here is it is a 9%.
tax, but it's a state tax that goes to the state. So Pike and the council members are saying, hey, what about us? You know, this is, they don't call it a cash cow. They're quoted as saying it's a cash calf. It's about $30 million. But they're very vigorous in saying, Mr. Comptroller, we're happy to, you know, work with you, but you got to pay the money back. And I happen to find that to be, frankly, really a bad approach to a bad idea.
Well, but couldn't both sides, could, but couldn't
in other words,
both
the extra revenue is going to say, if what you're suggesting is could the state do the rational thing and maybe give the counties some bridge money the first 3 years to phase in until the private sector runs everything and you have more restaurants opening and more hotels and more taverns, more, just more business that would ultimately approve the county. Yeah, that is a compromise that you know, you might think about, but it's very difficult. The state is as recalcitrant as the county to give you anything else. This is just a matter of a really, really dumb idea being supported stubbornly for reasons.
You could show economically where it's a win-win to both
state and the nobody needs to be convinced anymore. And the public's totally convinced. They want the reform. The legislators want it also, but they're conflicted because they have people saying you can't do this. And you have people like Ike raising concerns, and someone I have a lot of respect for. The inertia of the current system is something that has to be dynamited out of the way. And the economic report I'll think about, but I don't really have that in my budget to do, but maybe we can ask some folks in the private sector.
I had another, just quickly.
Go ahead, that was a good idea.
Just a thing, does the state have any ability to restrict the county from entering into financial obligations which could impair the state?
Yes, I do. I consider that to be an issue here because we have thousands of Montgomery County citizens that go into the district to buy their alcohol. And on this particular issue, and I happen to think that's why it's a state issue, not a Montgomery County issue, because the 9% liquor tax, sales tax on liquor, goes to the state. Therefore, in my simplistic way, the inefficient system that Montgomery has is not just a local issue, it's a state issue. Good question, though. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, this is a question I threw you a few years ago at a committee for Montgomery Breakfast. The homestead tax credit. A number of people I've read you about are living in the best of big incomes, and suddenly they stopped paying income tax to Maryland. I speculated that it was because they also had second and maybe even third homes in other states that were more friendly in terms of income tax, and then declared their primary residency elsewhere, in which case they shouldn't have been getting the homestead tax credit. You said that would be fixed. Has that been fixed?
I don't know, but I'm happy to check on it. Just being honest. I'm good, but I'm not a genius. So we'll see. Well, I indicated it was going to be fixed, and I assume we did something. Where's Chris Cole? Is he here? Yes, he's with my agency. That's such an easy question, Chris. Do you have an answer?
No, I don't.
Hopefully it's another agency called State Department of Assessments and Taxations. One of the absolutely 100% completely dysfunctional agencies in the state government. But I often get confused with them and because of the name. We'll check and get back. Chris, if you could come up and get her contact information, we'll follow up tomorrow.
Thank you.
Paul, yes?
I had two questions. One quick question. Could you stream the Board of Public Works?
Yes, it is.
They are streamed.
Yep.
Okay.
It doesn't look very good. It's kind of a bad thing, but I mean, it's not a great video, but
you can definitely listen in, and you know, I would encourage everyone to do it.
And my other question is about the, you said your staff goes and meets with the agencies to
yep.
prepare. A lot of times in Montgomery County, the citizen's voice is really cut out of the agency, or the agency will go before the Board of Public Works or the Board of Education and basically keep lying about the facts on the ground. Do you ever, I mean, is it possible for you to reach out to citizens' groups that are involved in specific cases?
No, that's a little, yeah, that's a little hard for me, because that's not my role, that's your role. And the agendas are printed in advance. And sometimes, like we had a group from Deep Creek Lake and Barrett County come and complain about $1 million land purchase that we made. They claimed that it was twice what the appraisal was, and that it would threaten the quality of life around Deep Creek Lake. And I said, well, that's terrific that you're here, but we approved it 2 weeks ago. I mean, I'm good, but I'm not that good. That,
so if we see something on the agenda, it's yeah. not too late to
No, know. Not at all.
Because we had situations where we were locked out, you know, like the Board of Public Works, and they wouldn't let us.
Yep, yeah, locked well, out by armed guards.
Right.
That's my, I'm the open sesame.
Thank you.
I'm not saying I'm going to agree on anything you guys do, but that's I'm sympathetic to the issue of transparency. Yes, sir.
Going back to education, you mentioned $500 per square foot cost, et cetera, et cetera. I've been trying to do research on a statewide basis for
right.
school construction, and I'm getting numbers that were surprising me. For example, for Paint Branch, getting all the contract, all the stuff sent to me over from Annapolis, and it came to $236 per square foot.
Yeah, well, good.
Which is surprising.
Sure, is that with me, because that reminds me of the latest job figures we got. The new one's coming out this Friday. We get them from the federal government. Right? Out of Olympus, they open up and they say 3,000 jobs were created in Maryland. Asked my staff, could you please look at that? They looked at it and they found that half of them were attributed to public employment. And a chunk of them were coming right out of Baltimore County. So I had the staff call up Baltimore County and say, you guys hired several hundred new employees? I said, nope, we haven't hired anyone. I mean, maybe the labor statistics are accurate, but if in the federal government's survey they say 300 public jobs were created in Baltimore County, and that's based on our estimates, and we call Baltimore County and they say actually the number is zero, it at least makes you think about whether those figures are correct. The Paint Branch figures may be absolutely correct, but send them to me, because right now the figures we're dealing with are over $400 a square foot.
Can you give me figures?
Sure. There's public testimony at the Board of Public Works from Dr. Lever, the head of the construction.
No, would I get that?
I'll send you the transcript. Yeah. Yep. Great. Or talk to me if you. We'll find a favor. You give us a card. Now, part of that is forward-looking, because they're saying that construction costs are skyrocketing, and they've got all sorts of explanations as to what is going on. But my response is, well, that's great. I don't care what's costing it. We can't afford it.
Well, Paint Branch is a palace. I mean, fit schools inside the area where the kids can just kind of sit around as they walk in the building.
Now, I have a vision of schools that are built to last 40 years, and they use steel and concrete, and they're beautifully designed. They look like the west wing of the art museum, made out of glass, cantilevered full floors, so that you look down on the dance area, you look down on the basketball court, you look down on the theater, and they're they're works of art. People drive from New Jersey to come down and look at that school because it's so beautiful. And that's what they built over in Arlington, the Wilson Elementary School. $250 a square foot.
Yeah.
That is a real figure from the architect. And what do we build? Well, I would say beautiful is not the word I would associate with it, but they're certainly expensive.
Houston's driving their costs down to the low 100s.
Yeah, but the key here is to drive them down and make them beautiful. Because the kids and the teachers are fine. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Careful function is, that's getting back into, well, we'll see. But I think there's an opportunity, I happen to have a very positive relationship with Governor Hogan, who would have thought he and I have a strategic partnership. He's very interested in doing more school construction for a cheaper cost. So we have, not because he wants to cut schools, he wants to do more for the schools. He's getting castigated on a daily basis by my party, claims that he's anti-kid, anti-school, because he's holding up something called GCEI, which you can find five people in the state that know what that is.
This room would have them. Exactly.
Really.
This room
it's
does.
All politics and all theater because, for whatever reason. But I can pretty much guarantee that he and I see the same on school construction cost. And the thought is to take the school construction dollars and spread them much more widely and build schools that more functional and more beautiful. And, you're seeing examples of it. There's a charter school that uses public school teachers in rural Maryland called Marlin Academy. We went and toured. They sat down and said, this beautiful school that we have is exactly identical to an Anne Arundel school down the street. Not the street, 3 or 4 miles away. Same number of students, same public school teachers, same functions, everything, blah, 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 blah. We built it for 2/3 the price. They said 34%. No, they're just, I said, how did you do that? They said, we built it the last 40 years, not 100 years. We used commercial construction standards, not the standards that are built up year after year by the school system. So I think it's a victory for common sense if we could do that. And I've told Governor Hogan that the campaign can wait. The campaign season is still 3 years away. In the next 2 years, anything that he brings that he wants me to take a look at or help the state, I'll look at it. And I put my partisan sword down. Right there. And you would be amazed at how many people love that. I mean, and I think it would be good for the state. You guys have been terrific. Thank you very much.